Last week, it was wonderful to have a sermon for the children, and I hope that you were able to hear it. It was a very simple idea, but I think one that is very powerful to think about as adults, which is what we want and what we do isn't always what we need. And secondly, what we really need, the one thing needful in the Bible, is fellowship with God in Christ. That's the one thing that we need. And sadly, we seem to be pursuing other things, and maybe we'll discuss why today. So this particular season and this Sunday of the Forefathers is about that. It's about people throughout history who have known that they needed the Savior. Not just another prophet, not just a good, wise king and ruler to make things economically and socially fine, but the Savior of their souls, the Son of God. And that's the sense, is that there's been a long awaiting throughout these generations. Think about, from Abraham through Isaiah and Malachi and the Maccabees to John the Baptist, this desire, the desire for God. And so this is a time where we focus on that birth, the birth of the one who has been so desired for so long. And maybe it's also a time to think about our own birth, the meaning of birth. I was thinking it's not just that the Lord was born in Bethlehem 2,000 years ago. That's wonderful news. But if he is not born day after day, year after year, in the dark cave of our heart, then how good is it to us? St. Paul, in his letter to the Galatians, it's a very harsh letter, if you read it, and he says that if you get circumcised and insist on all those things, this Christ will be of no avail to you. And that's a thought. It's possible for the Son of God to accomplish all these things, to be incarnate, to be born, to do all these miracles, to teach, to die, to reign, and it could be of no avail to us. I think the season of the birth of Christ is Christ going to be born again this year? In the world, well, slim chance, right, since we can hardly say Merry Christmas, but at least what about our own dark cave? That's the question. I remember my mentor, to an extent, Father Meletios, whenever we arrived around the Pascha time, became agitated, and he told me, is it going to happen again this year? Is at this Pascha am I going to experience the resurrection? It was about here and now, the entering now into the spiritual things. And what about our own birth, which we celebrate, or I may even say over-celebrate in our culture, though without much thought about what it's all about? Because we didn't ask to be born, as we sometimes tell our parents during our teenage years. We were invited into this world, right? Invited into this beautiful world to do what? What is the invitation to live about? What is the gift of God, which is really undeserved and really not even requested? What is the gift about? Of course, during this week, there was the falling asleep, as we say in the church, that's a nice expression, of the famous astronaut John Glenn. He was 95. That's a long life. He accomplished many incredible things. I heard that once he came back from a flight mission, he was a pilot before, an astronaut, with 200 bullet holes in the airplane. And somehow this man flew, turned missions, went into orbit, went into space at 75 years old, was a senator, and still, but I had to check, still was a man of faith. But The point isn't so much, you know, how far have we traveled, including outer space, but is what was the point of this invitation of life? I also heard about Kirk Douglas, who just turned, I guess, 100 years old. It's like, okay, it's wonderful. Some of us may desire that or not, I'm not sure. But was the essential, the needful thing accomplished? That is the question. And I think the invitation given to us as we enter into this world, hopefully we've heard it. I think it's echoing throughout the universe. It's the proclamation of this eternal good news by the love of God, His desire for us in Christ Jesus. And there's a beautiful text in Revelation, the last verses. I think the Bible ends with the invitation. It says, "Blessed are those who wash their robes." So they do something, actually. They wash their robes so that they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter the city by the gates. Then it says, it's an echo, in fact, from the epistle. It's good news for those who want to be in the city and be at peace. It's bad news for some. But outside are the dogs. That doesn't mean the literal dogs. We like dogs. The nice ones. And the sorcerers, and fornicators, and murderers, and idolaters. And then I think it's interesting, and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. So I guess fake news have been around for a long time. There is a tendency in the human race, it's a mystery, to sometimes prefer the false over the true. That's a disease that we've inherited. We hear things, and somehow, sometimes the false resonates more than the true. It really takes grace and spirit to discern. Then it says, verse 16, "It is I, Jesus, who sent my angel to you with his testimony for the churches. I'm the root and the descendant of David." So this Sunday is about that, this line. "The bright morning star." So even the sunset and the sunrise proclaim the gospel to all of us who are able to sense it. And then he says, "The Spirit and the bride say, 'Come,' and let everyone who hears say, 'Come,' and let everyone who is thirsty come, let anyone who wishes to take the water of life as a gift come." So it's an invitation to come. And in fact, it's a free banquet. In the parable today, it's not, "I made a great supper and there's a ticket you have to buy." It's a free gift. The parable, of course, has a mystery. Maybe you've thought about it. It seems to me that these guests had agreed in advance to come. It seems to me that way. Not sure. And then so the master now has prepared the food, and he sends the servant to say, "Everything is ready, come." But something has happened. And they all begin to make excuses. Now I have to look at the Greek term, because I think the key word in this whole parable is that they were making excuses. I'll let you judge if there are good, valid excuses. Some of them might be, some of them aren't, right? But the Greek word says, I won't attempt to pronounce it, it is to get around something. They have to get around, to have nothing to do with, to refuse to hear, to beg to escape. And that's what they convey. "I beg you, just escape." And I was thinking, you know, everybody thinks that someone else will go. The "come" seems to be very vague, you know. "Come." But it's not vague. It's addressed to each of us. It is really the individual proclamation. If we all say, well, I use "Jack" as a generic name, "Jack will go, so I don't have to go," well, no. Right? That's how no one shows up. Right? So you have a birthday party, and sometimes and then nobody shows up because everybody thinks someone else will go. But the responsibility is always upon me. It's always what matters. Now those excuses, those getting around, if you notice, they're all really self-centered. It's all about thinking about me. It's my wife, my field, myself. It's never considerate about the other. And most of all, it's not about fellowship. What the man wants is to have fellowship, to have a meal, and to have communion, togetherness with people. But the excuse is to reject that. I think that's profound. You know, the blessing given to us from the Bible and on Sunday is the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is his undeserved kindness to us. The love of God, when we add the Father, and the kinonia, the fellowship, the togetherness, the community of the Holy Spirit be with us. You know, the Spirit creates community. Now we're free to come, as you've noticed, or to leave. And that's the point, is that it activates our desire to be in this community and to be joined. When I was much younger, maybe 12 or 13, I had a neighbor. I won't tell which one, unless he's watching the video. I would feel bad. But I had a neighbor who loved to watch television. And very often, if he had to choose between watching his TV show and coming out to be with people, he chose the TV show. And I was marked for life that I shall never choose, you know, the self stuff, the TV show, the video game, over any invitation to be with people. And I tried to live by that rule, and I hope it worked more or less in my life. But it was hard sometimes. We have to fight to embrace togetherness. And why do we make excuses? Why did they? Why do we? Well, I think it's what we perceive to be of value to us. It's what we want to do. They really wanted, at that time, to be with their wife, to be in the field, to be somewhere else. When we look back at our year, and it's a good time to do it, the scary thing is that we did exactly what we wanted to do. We may have said in a vague way, oh, I want to visit so-and-so, I want to go to a retirement home, play the piano, I want to visit, you know, give to this, and read the Bible, and do all those things, and do less of this or that. But fact is, we've done exactly what we wanted to do. And that's something we have to think about. It was that we seem to be doing things, in the end, if we want to do them, because it's the path of least resistance. But there's a gully where I live, because there's a lot of water, especially now, and we had to do a kind of a ditch, and the water is always flowing, you know, into this ditch. That's the law of the universe. Things always move according to the path of least resistance. And so do we. And I was hearing the Gospel of Mark seminar, you missed it if you didn't come, and when the Lord says, if you say to this mountain, you know, be removed and go into the sea, it will happen. Now, I think it doesn't refer to actual mountains. That's been tried, I think, but you can't really remove mountains physically. But I think it means you can change the landscape of your spiritual life. You can reshape it so that the water will flow where it needs to flow. I think we have also to say it. Someone said, I don't know who it was, who said, well, when we, you know, if we think things in our heads, it's one thing, but if we stand up and say out loud to God what we desire, there's power in words uttered. I believe that. It's not magic, but I think when the Lord heals, he speaks out the words. And so should we, to utter what it is that the Lord, through faith, can remove from us, to reshape our landscape, that the water may flow where it needs to flow. So in this season, I think it's easy to miss the one thing needful. It's easy to miss the invitation to be there in fellowship on Christmas night and to make excuses. It's true. It's difficult day after day to choose the one thing needful, but the invitation is awesome. On the one hand, the Lord invites us to have fellowship with Him. Remember, Emmanuel means God with us. And in the Holy Spirit, it even becomes God within us. That He truly, if we accept this invitation, enter His door and also let Him come into our own door, that He may be all in all and be glorified in us who have received all things undeservedly before because of His glory. To Him who is drawing us near to this feast, be all praise to the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, now and forever, and to the ages of ages. Amen. Glory be to Jesus Christ.
Glory forever and ever.